Yesterday, Joe Biden was officially sworn in as the 46th president of the United States, while Kamala Harris became the first woman to be vice president. The day was emotional as history was made. On his way out of the office, Donald Trump made 143 pardons and commutations just before he relinquished power. Today on the show, we have our comedy hype analyst, Doug Williams, calling in and Rita Brent in the studio to talk about the inauguration. Now guys, for me watching the inauguration and seeing Donald leave, it was a mix of emotions. One, I'm watching history being made, but then honestly on the other end, I'm like, is there gonna be any retaliation? You know, just kind of staying up on my toes, but nonetheless, it was just a day full of different emotions for me. So Doug, starting with you, watching the inauguration, watching Donald leave, and of course we have Kamala as the first black, not only black woman, but the first woman as vice president, and then Joe Biden as our president. What were your feelings and your emotions during that time?
First of all, you guys look great. You should be on his cabinet, or at least they should have had you guys speaking at the podium yesterday. You look great.
Thank you.
You know, bunch of mixed emotions just from everything that has transpired within the past 2 weeks. First of all, I just want to note real quick that we had people storm the Capitol to take over, and these same people were the people that accused NFL players who kneeled to peacefully protest police brutality in black and Hispanic communities. They were the first ones to say those players were unpatriotic and they were being disrespectful to the flag. Yet they charged the Capitol, attacked police officers, broke in, and you violated trespass. So there's just really a double standard in this country. And I think that with 45 being president, we saw an unprecedented amount of hypocrisy. Secondly, I just want to say that I think everybody was just so happy to see the diversity that was on display yesterday and the diversity that is coming in with the new President Biden. He has gone out of his way to include everybody from the gay population, from the Muslim population, the black population, the Hispanic population. And that's the America that we live in. We all want to feel a part of this country. And with Donald Trump being in office, it was about one race, and that was the white race. And I think that's what people are failing to see. And that's what's so frustrating to me when I see black people supporting Donald Trump. Donald Trump hired over 200 judges, appointed 200 judges. Not one was black. So this is bigger than Republican or Democrat, because I agree with some of the Republican values. But to me, Donald Trump represented genocide. He represented the absence of color, the absence of ethnicity. And America has changed. We are a country now that is inclusive of all people. And we still have a long way to go as black people. And that's evident recently with the lack of hiring of black head coaches in the NFL. But yesterday was a great celebration. I loved it. The first African-American / Asian vice president. It just warmed my heart. And I made sure that my kids were there to watch it. And it was just like a celebration on Bourbon Street.
Absolutely. And Rita, you know, I've followed you on Instagram. I've watched, you know, throughout this entire journey, and we've kind of had our own conversations off air about just seeing things unfold. You know, even when Donald was the president, you know, just seeing the different things that was happening around us. And you've been very vocal in, you know, not only pushing a message, but getting people to get out there and vote. You even came up with the Kamala Harris song, you know, that I've pushed and I've listened to. What were your emotions, you know, seeing this change actually happen, all the work that we put in, all the time that we fought, the things that we've seen our people do to fight for this moment, like it was the time and it's happening. What was your emotion?
Well, first of all, I think it's interesting that you mentioned that you feared retaliation, because that is the type of president that Trump was. He was the type who made America feel like a hostile environment. He felt like a president from the 60s, and I wasn't even there for the 60s, but the kind of environment that he was perpetuating, you had black folks getting beat up at rallies, you know, the Confederate flag was flown, as Doug mentioned, at the U.S. Capitol riots. It was a glorious day for me, and I would be fine if we never mentioned his damn name ever again, because it was that praise and that glorification, that's what got him there in the first place. And what I kept thinking about was Martin Luther King Day. because on Martin Luther King Day, I felt so freaking heavy to the point that I could not post anything. I wanted to post a quote, but I couldn't even reflect on his speech without thinking about the things he talked about in his speech have not been realized or manifested today. He talked about equalism, equality, people being equal. And as we saw at the U.S. Capitol riots, if those were black protesters, they would have gotten beaten, they would have gotten mauled. These protesters were allowed to go back home and carry on about their day. So no, we're not equal. He spoke about liberty. We don't have liberty either. If we're thinking about financial freedom, we don't have that because there are descendants of slave masters who are living on the land that is owed to us. We don't have financial freedom. If you think about the justice system, black people are disproportionately in these jails for the same or lesser crimes than our counterparts have committed. I could not post a quote of Martin Luther King's because we're hailing him as a hero. But I don't know if people know, after that speech, the FBI deemed Martin Luther King a threat to the nation. A threat to the nation, all because he was fighting for racial justice and economic justice. And here you have Trump, who is also being hailed as a hero, and all he represents is sexism, racism, nepotism, all of the isms. So I was just so heavy, and I'm just like, listen, what we have to do is move forward at this point, right? And that's why I got so frustrated when people were talking down about Kamala Harris. You know, it shouldn't be easier for you to put somebody down than it is to uplift them. Because what's happening is Kamala is risking her life. She's risking her family's life. Trump didn't risk shit. If anything, he got more powerful. You understand what I'm saying? So I think that if we need to either put up or shut up. Do the work. Stop complaining about candidates not being perfect. They're not going to be perfect. Obama wasn't perfect, partly because Congress was against him just because he was black. He couldn't get Merrick Garland in because Congress blocked that. So before you get on your computers and type shit about folks, think about the risk they are taking. Yeah. I'm wearing Mega Evers earrings today because he died. He was a martyr. He was killed because he was fighting for the rights of black people. So I am hopeful that we will move into a new direction. No, I don't think racism is just going to magically end. No, I don't think Biden and Harris are going to be the cure. But my dream is that we will start to overcome. I think that song was so vague because it says we'll overcome someday. Well, no, damn it. We want to overcome today. You understand what I'm saying? We want to start today. So I'm just hopeful that we will move in a better position. Because Trump was a stain on America. You think about a shirt that you have a stain on. No matter how you wash that shirt, that stain is going to stay. Trump was that stain. He was a stain for America's that is his legacy. He was the stain of America, like a boo-boo stain on some drawers. You know, so now we got some new drawers. We're going to have some new drawers in America, and it's time to move forward. So that was horrible.
You know, make no mistake about it. You know, Trump ran the White House and America like Suge Knight ran Death Row Records. I mean, it was just out of control.
That's true. And I want to ask for you, Rita, too, because I know for me, being a black woman, seeing Kamala be the first black, like, vice president, and it was overwhelming for me because it's like, that's a representation of me. So for you, as someone who has had to go through the Trump era, if you will, mm-hmm. as not only a black woman, but as someone who's been very open about your sexuality, mm-hmm. very open about the things that you encounter, the things that, you know, whether it's on the road or on the internet and different things like that, what does it mean for you to see Kamala in that place?
So when I see Kamala, I see representation. I see myself because she represents black women. She represents Indian women, Asian American women, Jamaican women. I mean, the diversity just enthralled in her alone is huge. So when I look at Kamala, I just think, hey, if she can do it, I can do it. It makes me feel like so much is possible. And that's why I was so frustrated with people challenging her about her prosecutorial record. It's not about the challenging and it's not about the accountability. If you would just listen to her, she said that she took the position so she could represent and help black people who were being, falsely accused, or if it's a white prosecutor, it's gonna be a different outcome.
Absolutely.
You know what I'm saying? So Kamala represents so much, and even her being in an interracial marriage, you know, that says something because that wasn't allowed back in the day.
Yeah.
And here it is, her husband is making history as the first, what is he, the first, second man, or
right.
first, yeah, whatever he is. I don't know what would you call it, but that's what he is. Yeah. So yeah, she, and I saw so many little girls watching this. I was in tears. I was in tears, and people were on my Facebook arguing because I said she had on a blue suit. They was like, nah, it's purple. I'm like, fuck all that. We need to focus on the moment. Yeah. I don't care about what color she has on. The thing is, this is a woman who is in a position when, and her sorority, my sorority, Delta Sigma Theta, one of the first social justice acts we did was we were in the women's suffrage movement. So to know that she's in a sorority that fought for her very right to be in that position, for her to take that oath, that was just amazing. It was amazing and it was historic. And I think we ought to honor the moment. I don't think we ought to say anything else about 45. His Twitter shut down. We don't have to hear shit from him. We don't have to hear shit from Melania talking about B-Best. I don't even know what tense that is. Who the hell says that? But we just need to forget that and focus on where America is going now. And Biden and Harris represent what America can be.
Absolutely. And Doug, as we close out, is there anything that you want to say to the people? Because I think for you, over your lifespan, you know, you've seen different presidents and encountered different things. So just your experience in life outside of our industry, outside of what we see on the internet, just experiencing different presidents, is there anything that you want to say to the youth to kind of give them that encouragement that we are in a new day? This is a new time. So I want to give you the floor for that.
What's up, sis? I didn't know you were a Delta, you know, Omega Psi Phi Fraternity Incorporated in the house. So, you know, I knew it was something special about you, but that took it to a whole nother level. I just want to say this. What made President Obama so special, I think, not just to Black people, but just to common people, is that Obama represented us in the sense that he came from a single parent home. He knew what it was like to struggle, to have, you know, to budget, to almost have the lights cut off. And I think Kamala brings that to the White House as well. You know, we needed someone, and this is what we were lacking with Donald Trump. We needed someone to represent or to be there when decisions are made who could think about the common person. You know, she went to an HBCU. She knows what it's like to struggle. Again, she came from a single parent home. So it's vital whenever you have the highest office, the upper echelon of offices, you need someone there who is going to have the mindset of the common person. And she's a like-minded person. So when decisions are made, we know someone is sitting at the table who has been in our seat and who's going to make a decision on our behalf. And I think that's what's so special about having Kamala in the White House.
Absolutely. And then Rita, to close out with you, as I mentioned, you've been someone that's pressed so hard for it. Why is it so important to press hard for, you know, situations that we've seen coming from 45 to now President Joe Biden? Why do you feel it's so hard for people? Because I feel like the younger generation kind of feel, you know, I don't have a voice. Mm-hmm. I don't, you know, my vote doesn't matter. But I think this was a time that it shows that, you know, actually it does matter when we all come together and press hard for it. It does matter. So for you, why do you feel like it's so important? And why was it important for you to press as hard as you did for this election?
Yeah, so when we just think about voting, listen, I'm from Mississippi, right? And when I speak about Medgar Evers, this is a man who gave his life so that I might have the right to vote. Blood was literally shed so we could have the right to vote. And that in and of itself lets me know that this is important. Clearly there's some kind of power to be had from the vote if our ancestors were willing to die for our rights to do it, right? But I think it's a mixture. I don't think that we should put all of our faith in the government. I think that we need to take initiative to do the work as well. It is very easy to sit back and type and talk shit all day on blogs or whatever, but what are you doing in your community? Are you the Stacey Abrams of your, you know, Stacey, that is such a beautiful story because she was snubbed for governor, but look what she has done now. What if she had just given up, you know? What if Kamala had just given up when folks were coming for her? What if? What if she didn't say, I think that I have what it takes to run for president, and now she's in this position? So I think it's just a reiteration that, hey, qualifications do matter, because I think Trump set that bar extremely low. When we think about Obama, he had to be damn near perfect on paper to even be considered. And then you have white privileged Trump to come up who was unqualified, who had no presidential qualities at all, and he was put into that position. I think it's just we're hitting the reset button. And so, yes, you do have a voice. You do have a voice. And what you do now is going to determine your future. What you do now, it doesn't matter how old you are, that's gonna determine your future. So I think we need to continue voting. I think we need to continue being involved and do the work personally, in the community, grassroots as well, not just, you know, depending on the government to rescue us.
Absolutely. Well, I just want to say congratulations to us all. We're in a new day and a new time, and I'm definitely looking forward to the future, what the future
holds.
Yes,
Hercules.
Thank you both so much for not only joining, but also chiming in. I think this is a great time and a stamp in our history, and we have it marked. So you heard from us. We want to hear from you in the comments below. For Comedy Hype News, I'm Symphony Thompson.